motion animation of how a film camera is being assembled.
So our documentary will be about how cinema as an art form approaches the other, and what part does a reflexive documentary play in cinema, or like approaching the other or understanding the other.
Okay. All of a sudden I'm like, because when you say cinema as an art form, I'm thinking all kinds of films. I'm thinking also fiction films, not just documentary, and I'm of course also non-reflexive documentaries. For one thing, starting out as cinema as an art form is, I think I'd say, problematic, but you need to keep in mind that this is also a business and it takes all kinds of different things into consideration. Most of the time, reflexive documentaries tend to be made with either political reasons or as an art form. So when you break it down to reflexive documentaries, there's more to be said there. But with reflexive documentaries, what they do is they reveal their forms of storytelling. They reveal the fact that they are a film, that they are a documentary. So whatever they do, we always are reminded that this is a documentary made by a certain people who have a certain define itself in a certain way and has had a certain other that they have been approaching. So with reflexive documentaries, there's at least a possibility that they reveal how they should be writing as well. So just normalizing what you're making and trying to get into something is not guaranteed, but it's more likely that you're going to see.
What strategies do you think the cameraman should use to capture authentic moments without intruding on the subject's personal space?
We're talking about documentaries, right?
Yes.
And reflexive documentaries. Well, I'm not a camera person, so maybe that should be a better person to answer that. But what I notice in films and gain from talking to filmmakers is keeping the crew small helps, not having a whole bunch of people intruding, and also just be there for a long time. Well, the camera person, the director, if they spend enough time with the subjects and the subjects are used to these people being around them, the camera being around them, they start acting more and more normal since their normal becomes a camera in the room. So I think that's the best way to go around that. But of course, no matter what you do, as soon as there's a camera there, we become self-conscious. We think twice about what we say. And there are, as I said, they try to get around this by spending more time, making them more comfortable, etc. But as long as they know there's a camera, there's always that, little difference.
I guess. Another question was, how responsible filmmakers for the perspective that the subject in front of the camera creates on the audience?
Very responsible, I would say, because it's, yes, the subject is a certain way, kind of personality, you know, they have their own characteristics, you know, they say certain things, etc. But how they are filmed, from which angle, for how long, and even more importantly, how that's edited afterwards, what is left out, what is brought together, maybe from different times in the subjects, like certain moments are brought together, and then that means something else. So the whole responsibility, almost the whole responsibility, in the final product, lies with the filmmaker. So, you know, this is how this person is. This is how I am showing you this person.
But sometimes it can turn into something that is like whole different than what the maker is thinking. Like maybe in fact she is approached to the topic. It can change and criticize in a different way. So what do you think when those kind of moments happen? Like what position should the maker be in?
The thing about documentaries is it has to be a lot more flexible than fiction film. In fiction film, you write your scripts, you have directors who are professional and should act exactly the way you want, and you just give them instructions and things come up. With a documentary, the exciting thing is you don't have any guarantees like that. So the filmmaker needs to adapt to whatever is not there, to whatever they cannot get out of that person, or maybe their opinion changes, etc. So during filmmaking, that requires a lot of flexibility. If you mean perhaps the audience sees something else in the final product than what the filmmaker intended, that's why filmmakers show their films to their friends first. They show them around, they show them to different people, they show them to people they trust, critics, other filmmakers, sometimes just family members who can maybe give an opinion as a regular audience member. And before they finalize the product, they actually get feedback from people. They have the first draft, before they get to the final cuts. From the rough cut, there are several versions, almost always, and that helps preventing things like that.
Thank you so much. The last question, I think you've already answered. It was about how does the filming process in a reflexive documentary break the fourth wall, and what impact does it have on the audience, or the engagement with the audience, and like, what does the audience do? Because you said to make a reflexive documentary, the most important thing is to make the person, people behind the camera, more comfortable, so they don't change their behavior, so they get used to the camera as an entity stays there, so they get kind of accustomed.
Yes, well, you can have that in non-reflexive documentaries as well. With a reflexive documentary, the difference is you remind the audience that there is a camera and this person is talking in front of the camera, and you know, it's the making the elephant in the room visible. For which you need an extra camera filming the camera, so you have even more people in the room, which makes it even more uncomfortable. But yes, at least for the audience, it's sort of a reminder that this is not natural life as it is, which was that still is the claim of some observatory documentaries, which is of course very difficult to update. It's a camera. Unless you hide the camera, and then we get into very ethical and big questions.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for your time.